Hi, this is Tyler Blake with ExoWhips again, and today I'm just going to be responding to some requests I've been getting on how to do weighted fall. So this is one way to do it. There are others. This is my favorite, but I'm not saying there's anything wrong with other ways that you might know about. So first off, for the materials we'll be using is just bead chain. This is 3/32 of an inch, and I want to say that's classified as number 10 on ballchain.com, but it's a little bit thinner than what you would normally find on like an old light pole at your grandmother's house. And the fall that I'm going to be working on is going to be 28 inches, so I cut this to 24, and there'll be a short unloaded section at the end. And then I have my red paracord here, and this is, I think I cut this at about 66 is what I usually do. So it's always better to go a little bit long than a little short, right? And this is going to take a little while, so just everybody pull up a chair and get comfortable. So for the tools I'm going to be using today, you need to be able to make fire. I have a little bit of electrical tape, scissors, needle nose pliers. I have an awl, which is optional, but I like to use it. I have a lacing needle here, and there are different kinds. A lot of people use the jumbo permalocks from Tandy. I think that this is highly superior to that, and I've used these on another video before, but these are made by Lassie Karenvall over in Sweden, and I get them from my friend Roy Partin over at whipnation.com, and I recommend you do the same. Okay, and then this here, Jesse, I'm looking at you. This is called a lacing bodkin, and let me hold this up a little bit closer here. This has, on this end, it's kind of hammered flat, and there's a hole punched through it, and this end is a round knob. And the great thing about these is that, well, there's another style of weighted fall that some people use where they just run a lead-loaded line through paracord. And you just put the lead line in that hole and you're good to go. That's actually how I load the first bellies on my Night Train bullwhips, because the first belly in those is lead-loaded, and that's how I get it in there. With the knob, the nice thing about that is that it causes the paracord to swell, and you can see that little lump there as it goes down. It just it just helps it feed through. Especially if like this was sold to me as coreless by Roy Partin at whipnation.com. especially if you have like flat cord, that helps to open it up to feed through. Also, I have another one that doesn't have the knob, but sometimes that's going to poke through the side. Then with the knob, it creates a big enough surface where it's not going to do that most of the time. So, okay, so I'm just going to take a little bit of electrical tape and tape the chain to my bodkin. And if you don't have a bodkin, and by the way, you would find these at like Joanne Fabrics or the sewing section at Hobby Lobby or any place that sells sewing supplies. We'll have these. I want to say these are made by Dritz. And they do a ton of sewing accessories. So you don't have to have this. You could tape the bead chain to your lacing needle, but again, sometimes it's going to poke through the side of the paracord and you don't want it to. And also, this is a much larger diameter than the bodkin. So, and then when you add tape to that, maybe sometimes it's going to catch and want to peel off on the inside of the paracord. Because I could order paracord next time, and if it was made on a different lot than this one, maybe it's going to be a little bit bigger. Maybe it's going to stretch a little more. Maybe it's going to stretch a little less. Maybe it's going to be a tighter fit next time. So there are times where this will be harder to get through, and that's another reason I like to use the bodkin. So anyway, I'm just going to center the end of the bodkin about halfway on the length of the tape there, like so. And I'm going to try and line up the edge of the tape with the edge of the bodkin, right? So I'm going to fold that over. So, then I'll just butt the chain right up against the end of that, push it on, and then I'm just going to fold it over like a delicious taco. And then, so that's folded over, and I've got this big ol' extra flap of tape, and I'm just going to trim that off. And I'm just going to pinch that around and work it a little bit to make sure you want to make sure the chain is firmly affixed inside the tape so that it won't slip out while you're feeding it through. And one last thing, a further advantage of using the bodkin to do this over the needle is that this is longer. So while you're feeding this through, you can go further in between reset, you know, I'm pinching, sliding down. I find that easier with a slightly longer instrument than going, right? So, just keep feeding that. Let's get hung up on stuff. Okay, so now the bodkin has emerged, and I'm just gonna pull that about to there. Then I'm gonna reach down here and I'm gonna pinch where I can feel the bead chain. But past where the tape is, right? That's the important distinction. Then I'm gonna grab the bodkin on the tape and just kind of pull it out. So the tape all came out, and then I have the bead chain left inside there with no tape on it. So, and then, I don't know if this will show up well, but I can feel that the chain ends here and then this is empty. Okay? So, and I want that. So I'm just gonna melt the end of this. And then what I like to do is use the pliers, and I've seen other people just use like a little torch and slightly melt it and thread it right in. I've never been able to do that. Whenever I've tried to do that, I just end up with a gloppy mess and an unsecured piece of cord. So I'll squeeze that into like a little flat shape. And then because it's wider than the cord, it makes it easy. So I'm going to line up the edge of the pliers with the center line on the cord there and just fold that over. So now I have a little thing, and then I'm going to just kind of trim that up a little bit. So I find that doing it in this shape gives me the best result with getting it to thread into, whether it's these or whether it's, because I used to use the Jumbo Permalox from Tandy 2, but I find doing that gives me the best ability to get that to feed in and lock in tight, because I absolutely despise it when you're halfway through getting this fed through and the needle slips out or the bodkin comes undone or whatever. So you want to minimize that. Okay, so I have that on there, and I can feel right here the other end of the chain. So now I'm gonna go about 3/4 of an inch or so, and then you can do this however you like, but about 3/4 from the end of the chain, I'm going to make a hole with my awl. I'm just going to kind of twist that to make it as wide as possible. Okay. So I have that gaping maw, and then the lacing needle goes in there. And one of the reasons I like these needles better than the Jumbo Permalocks, the Jumbo Permalocks have that kind of flattened out, flanged out head on them. And there are some colors of paracord that'll slide right through, and there are some colors that I just could not ever get that to work on. So that was actually why I started using the bodkin. I just happened to... I was at, you know, the craft store looking for supplies one day, and I happened to see that and thought, hey, I could use that for that thing I need to do. And I've never had... Like, there's so many different colors of paracord, and like I mentioned earlier, they can vary from lot to lot, but I've never not been able to feed with the bodkin on any of them, so. Okay, so my loop is getting close to the size it needs to be. And you can do this either where the chain is inside the loop, or you can do it where the loop is empty and the chain starts right at the where the two ends of the loop join. So I don't know of one method being superior to the other. So a lot of the time I just kinda do it however it turns out. But I usually do it with the chain totally inside, I guess. So almost there. I'm gonna say one more. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so the chain is right there, and that's a perfect size loop for fall. So the end of the needle is here, and so you can, you know, you can just poke through, or you can use the awl, but I don't really need to, so I'm going to pull that through. I'll unscrew the needle, and then I'm just gonna pinch here and run my fingers down to take out any slack. And in that instance, the inner thread slips back in, which is just fine. If it doesn't do that and there's still some poking out, depending on how much slack you left yourself, then you just trim it level with air, run your finger down again, and it'll go in. So no problem there. Okay, so now. I always, when I'm doing a weighted fall, it's always going to be a double-ended fall. And the main reason for that is, I mean, I like the double-ended fall for the ease of changing crackers and never having them fly off. But the main reason I do that is for safety, because, you know, we've all heard the statistics about how fast a whip, you know, the end of a whip travels. You've got all these little, basically, BBs in here. And if you were ever cracking, and let's just say I just kind of singed that and tied it, put a cracker on it. If you were to use that and one of those balls shot out the end of there at, you know, hundreds of miles an hour and hit somebody in the eye, you'd have to live with that the rest of your life. So I heartily encourage you to make this a double-ended fall that's very secure. Because you just, you know, who wants that, right? So I'm going to... singe this end now, or melt it. Kids, if there are young'uns out there watching this, ask your mom and dad for help with this. Don't play with fire. And all of this sharp stuff, don't mess with that either. Okay, so now I have a disgusting glob there, but it's not gonna stay that way. So I'm gonna fold it over. Okay, there we go. And then it doesn't need to be anywhere near that big, so I'm gonna trim it up. Might have messed that up a little bit. I might have to re-singe, but that's another reason it's always better to leave yourself more room at the end than you need to, because then if you mess up, you have room to make corrections. But let's see if that works. Yep, just fine. Okay. So now, I've got my needle, and I can feel where the end of the chain is, so I'm just gonna bring the end of the needle where the paracord goes in, and place that evenly with where I can feel the end of the chain is. And now I know where this is, you know, how, where this needs to go. Okay. Oops. So the chain end is the one on top, the needle end is the one on the bottom there. So I need to feed that in. So I'm just going to take my awl and punch a little hole right here. And I probably could just use the needle, but this is like really sharp and it makes it easy. And it doesn't really matter which side you come in through. Okay, so I have my hole again. Needle just slides right in there. And then before I get too far with that, because I don't want to be trying to butt this up against the end of the lacing needle, I need to make another hole here, the exit hole. So I'll feel where the end of the chain is and make the hole, I'll just right up against where the chain is. It's like my awl is brushing up against the end of the chain as I do this. Okay, so now I have that hole, and I'll just very gently feed that through. And there you have the end for your cracker. Now I have a little bit extra space here, so what I'm going to do is pull this out just a little bit. Or no, sorry, did that the wrong way. I'm going to pull this end out a little bit, trim it even, and then I'll just pinch up here. Hello! And I'm going to run that down. So now the end where I trimmed the cord is butted up against the chain, and I still have my loop here. Now, I've heard that some people will just leave that like that and count on it, but I run it through a sewing machine to be safe, because again, if that ever shoots out and takes out somebody's kid's eye, you know, not good. So if you have a sewing machine, that's good news, because it's going to save you some time. I just put it on a center stitch setting, and that's going to vary from machine to machine, but I just, you know, set it under there and run. I'll start the stitch, backstitch it a little bit to lock it in, and I'll go all the way down on this, just on this unloaded bit at the end. Backstitch it again there, and then pull it off and trim the ends. I don't tie my knots because the backstitching locks it in. And then you have a really cool loaded fall, and it works great. If anybody who tries this, and I was actually going to do this and I didn't plan ahead enough. I was going to do this and an unloaded one and put crackers on both of them and show. You can just hold this in your hand, put a cracker on it, and flick it. Do the same thing with an unweighted fall, but that just has the paracord guts inside. And you'll be able to tell how the extra weight and mass in this makes it easier to get a crack out of. And I you know, it's a pretty lively fall. I think this feels, you know, to me this is a really decent approximation of a leather fall. And those of us who are into synthetic whips, we all love our synthetic whips, but we all want them to feel like leather, right? So, that, I guess, is everything here. If anybody... I am planning on doing some more how-to videos, so if anybody has something that they're curious about, you know, shoot me an email at tyler@exowhips.com, and I'll see about putting up a video for you. And, I'm also... I don't know if this will be of any interest to anybody, but I'm also going to branch out and start doing some videos on some of my other interests. I don't know if I'm going to set up a separate channel for that or not, but the main one will be art, you know, just different art tools and working on some drawings and things. So that is it for today. Thanks for watching. If y'all have any questions, let me know. We'll see you on the next one. Bye.